Jeez. So you may think you're getting away with something, but often what's happening is people are collecting evidence. And I know it's a cliche to say that honesty is the best policy, but I think it is. And, you know, if you're a person who's being investigated for multiple counts of fraud and tax evasion, that's somebody to avoid. And, you know, I try my entire life to be the diametric opposite of that.
To the Brutally Honest Show. This is Aaron
Drew. You know, I pay corporate taxes.
2010 MMA Reporter of the Year.
Business license.
Nominee.
Spirit Lake Tribe business license.
Known for my hijinks, getting beat up by Ronda Rousey, Chris Cyborg, Verdum, many more. Joined to my right, always, by my co-host, the co-star of the hit show Kingdom, and he does appear on tonight's episode, from the Clinch Report, the man, the myth, the legend, Jonathan King, and our audio, video, producer, K-Side Reporter. He's a Brazilian jiu-jitsu instructor, a Muay Thai practitioner, Aaron Gallegos. I love when he does that damn thumbs up if you're not watching the video. Always
handsome,
trolls me with it.
Handsome son of a gun.
We have an incredible show tonight. For the next 25 minutes, we're just going to shoot the shit, hang out, have fun, do guy stuff. Or excuse me, we're just going to do people stuff. Guys or girls, if you like having fun hanging out with us, go ahead. The next 25 minutes. In 25 minutes, who do we have on? That's when you say, come on.
Oh, you're cueing me?
Yeah.
It's cueing you.
Who do we have on in 25 minutes?
Kenny Ken Flow.
That's right. In 25 minutes from now, chill with us. We got Kenny K Flow Florian, UFC legend.
My favorite fighter of all time, which I've said many times.
And directly after that interview, if that's not enough, who do we have?
Dr. Anna Marie DeMars.
Dr. Anne Marie DeMars, Ronda Rousey's mother, well-educated, incredibly well-traveled, well-studied, and a world champion judo practitioner, Dr. Anne Marie DeMars, after the Ken Flo interview. But for the next 25 minutes, we're just going to chill and shoot the shit, have fun. We're going to do what we always do, start off with the beer of the week. And if you're not 21 or you just don't drink, don't worry about it. Grab yourself an ice-cold lemonade, a Diet Coke, a root beer, anything you want, a glass of ice water. But grab yourself a nice refreshment, get ready to chill. And with that being said, Adrian, let's have your beer of the week sponsored by Edwards Industries.
So the beer of the week this week is brought to you by Sudwark Brewing. It's called Best Friends. It's a coffee vanilla lager. I try to switch it up this time. Usually I bring in ales. I don't know if I've brought a lager before, but anyways, it's a really good beer. It has a little bit of chocolate in it, but coffee and vanilla. So test it out here in a second. Let me give you guys a pour.
My favorite part about these every week is the bottle. I love the labels on these things.
I like the knowledge, dude. You guys know me. I don't like to drink, but it's not so bad when Adrian explains it. It kind of makes it...
Well, because we're doing... Yeah, I don't drink beer
makes it
either,
interesting,
but
you know what
to
I mean?
Do it for like, the taste.
Kind of enjoy it when he explains
so
it.
So is a lager or an L, what's the difference?
That's a great question. You know what? We didn't even set that up. I was going to talk about the difference between a lager and an ale. So first let me pour my drink and I'll talk about it, right?
And if you haven't seen these incredible custom glasses we have from Edwards Industries, I love these damn things.
True, look at that color. With the light behind it.
So cheers to another show. We're almost close to our 20th show here.
That's right,
show 19.
All
right.
Big one tonight, boys.
Interesting. You know.
No bitter taste.
No bitter taste. Let me explain.
Which means low hops.
I'll explain the difference between lager and ale, and I can answer that afterwards. So the biggest difference between a lager and an ale is that they use two different types of yeast. The lagers use, I believe, their bottom, and the other ones are top. And basically, lagers are fermented at a cooler temperature. So they're more about 55 degrees to 50 degrees. And ales are about 60 degrees to 70 degrees. Anyways, besides the yeast that they use, they also lower alcohol because the yeast can only create so much alcohol.
In a lager.
Hold on a second. So the difference is that they're brewed at different temperatures?
Yes.
So how the... So,
not brewed, fermented.
So you're supposed to go in there and be like, hey, barkeep. I like my beer fermented at 73-ish degrees. I'll take a so-and-so. Or he would be like, should I go in there like next time as a smartass and say I want it fermented at X degrees?
No, see if he does it?
Excuse me, this fermenting temperature
like
tastes a bit off.
It's like what you said, the knowledge. Who the fuck would know that? I thought it meant one was yellow and one was dark.
No. They're different yeast that they're using. There's a little bit of a different flavor. It's very subtle. But the biggest difference is the yeast that they use. Also, ales because it's the yeast that they use, they create higher alcohol. The amount of alcohol that a beer has or that's being created is dependent on the yeast and how much sugar it has.
Right.
So a yeast has a certain tolerance. For example, some ales can only do 10%. Like when I made my, I think you guys had my double IP address, that one was 10%, but that's because that's the maximum that yeast could create. Otherwise, if I had more, I had enough sugar to probably make more alcohol. And but
10%, that's moonshine. That's crazy.
Yeah, yeah.
So. That Jim Tom stuff from the Moonshine Show, Jim Tom.
I was gonna say you remind me of that of the guy on Moonshine, the guy with the overalls who has a little dog.
I tell you, if that thing don't work, Jim Tom fix it, get a steel.
You gotta make it out of copper.
But, yeah, this is a good beer. You know what I do like about this? Is,
that was my first time ever doing that voice. I think I just nailed it.
I was going to say that, that what I like about this beer is it's not so heavy. Typically, stouts are very, very heavy, and this seems to be very light for such a dark beer.
And it doesn't have a bitter aftertaste.
No bitter.
Does that mean it's low hops?
Right. That's a great point,
Thank
Aaron.
You.
Yeah, yeah. So now you're learning. So
I'm
so
learning.
Actually, the balance between beer comes in the malt, how much malt and how many hops. The malt is the sweetness and the hops is the bitterness. So, you know, a lager or a stout will have lower hops. So, okay. Like an IPA or, you know, they even make double stouts, which is just double the ingredients, double the alcohol. And they're much more, they're bigger beers, right? So,
yeah, this, it also, right. It's got like a very subtle, carbonation to it, like it almost it tastes flat, but it feels carbonated. You okay. know what I mean? It's like
another great point. So here's another thing. I'll explain. Sorry, I don't want to be.
Hopefully, we're gaining
two for two on this.
Well, yeah, you're nuck. He's giving me the fist bump. We either just lost all the viewers or we gained like a whole audience. So, by the way, sorry to cut you off, but the next time we do a beer thing, can you save a glass of your new batch that's going to be done in a few weeks? Next time we do beer of the week, your beer.
I'll do my beer. My next beer is a really good beer.
All right, so answer his question, then we'll move on to the next
one. We'll move on. Okay. So not every beer is carbonated the same amount. All different styles, they demand different types of carbonation. So a stout or a porter usually has less. And the reason for that is because the carbonation can actually determine the taste of a certain beer. If it's higher carbonated, it can actually feel like it's more alcohol in it, right? So it changes the profile of the flavor. So a great question.
He's either a genius and well-educated on beer or just completely fucking with us, but we have no idea.
Yeah, they have no idea.
I'm kidding. I'm fascinated. I'm like, this guy's taking this like damn science.
He seriously could imagine be like, the tubulators are connected to the fistulators.
Imagine when he goes to a bar and orders a beer, how much of a pain in the ass he must be to the bartender. He's like, hey, let me go back there and fill the – with his thermometer. He's like taking temperature on the beer kegs. They're like, what are you, freaking bar rescue? Yeah.
You know, which one of us is going to be the idiot that fucks it up first in a bar being like, excuse me.
It will
off,
be me.
The fermentation's off on these hops.
I'm going to say, I like my beer at 73 degrees. I'll take a stagger. And he'll be like, what's a stagger? I'm like, you know, an L lager or whatever. All right. So, all right. Moving on to our co-host. You know, usually I've been known to be a little bit narcissistic, a little bit about myself, a lot of close-ups. Cue the close-up, Adrian. Cue the close-up. For those of you watching, I've been known to be a little bit into myself. I'm the only one with my own close-up camera on the show. Usually it's about me. I introduce myself first. I live in the past and Al Bundy style talk about a 6-year-old nomination I lost for an award. Tonight, cue the wide shot. Tonight, we talk to my friend Jonathan King. Not just my friend. My co-host, my partner on the show. Tonight, Jonathan King is on Kingdom, the hit show Kingdom, the episode tonight. Our co-host plays Grease Man number 2. And I was told he's the best Grease Man since Mick in Rocky, in the Rocky movies. How is it to be and where can we watch it?
Grease Man number 1, he spontaneously combusted on set. So we got to like shout out to him and his family. God rest his soul. I play a Grease Man on the show. It's pretty cool. I get to, you know, when you have a lot of connections in MMA, they kind of hook you up. Big Joe Daddy Stevenson, who is a huge friend of our show, by the way.
And just a great guy overall. He's a fun guy.
Awesome. One of the nicest people you ever meet in mixed martial arts or in any aspect of life for that matter. But he got me hooked up with the casting department, and every once in a while they call me in. And this one I actually got to grease up a couple of fighters, check for Vaseline before they got in the cage. So you're going to see my ugly mug on TV.
That's awesome, dude. We're really proud of you and really happy for you. And this is more incredible. You're going on the most epic. I don't know if you know about this, Adrian. Do you know about this?
I don't.
Okay, so Adrian, Clinch is going on, and I'm gonna basically cut him off and just narrate it as I normally do. Clinch is going on the most epic, amazing Vegas vacation trip / experience the next few days. Wouldn't it be cool if he started off the week by, I don't know, maybe going to the Ultimate Fighter? Wouldn't that be pretty cool? It'd be a little bit cooler if he fucking went the next day to the UFC 194. It'd be even cooler if he took a freaking Cadillac fat car with a celebrity out there and got hooked up by Marshall Zelnick, the UFC. Clint, tell us what you're doing the next few days.
Get the fuck out.
Yeah. Tell us what you're doing
the next few days.
Get
the fuck out.
Yeah, listen to this shit. He posted on Facebook yesterday or 2 days ago saying,
can anyone help me like get a ticket to UFC McGregor?
I wasn't fucking doom and glooming. I know for a fact big time Hollywood celebrities that have gone to their agents and said, I want tickets to Aldo McGregor. And you know what their agents say?
Talk to Jonathan King.
Go on StubHub and buy them because they're not available. The UFC is not giving away. There are not tickets to. You have to fucking really, really be big to get a fucking ticket to this.
Are you tooting your own horn right now?
No, we bought them. We went on StubHub.
You paid $900 each for 194, but it gets
you
crazy.
You bought them?
Yes, we bought them. We
$900 a ticket this guy paid.
No, well.
Guy right here to my right.
A shout out to a very good friend of mine.
He's, no way. He paid for your ticket?
Yeah. It's.
I'm a better travel mate. I'm more fun. I'm not married. Dante, is Dante listening to this? Dante?
Yeah, I hope he is.
I know you've seen the video of me. You know who I am. I'm a fun guy. I can drive the car. I'm trustworthy. Look at this. I mean, it's an easy decision.
If you have any questions about beer,
Get off my back.
But tell us about your experience. I want to live vicariously through you for a minute.
Yeah, so it's pretty cool. I mean, some of you guys that follow me on social media know that Peter Dante from the Adam Sandler movies.
Grandma's Boy.
Yep.
Sorry. Wait, hold on. Is he the one who played the quarterback on Waterboy?
Yeah, he was the quarterback.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. He's actually a huge MMA fan. And
aren't you coaches in lacrosse? Don't you coach
lacrosse? Yeah, we coach lacrosse together. He's actually a great lacrosse player, and this will play into this. He is having a really hard time with this fight, this UFC fight. He doesn't really give two shits about McGregor Aldo. He really wants to watch that fight, but he's having, like, heart murmurs over the co-main event. Because
dude, Weedman Rockhold?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Is he buddies with Rockhold?
He's really good friends with Luke Rockhold, but he's a graduate of Hofstra University, where he was an All-American lacrosse player.
Wow.
So he has this attachment to Hofstra University, so he's just really looking forward to seeing this.
Okay, so tell us how this trip's going to start. We want to feel like celebrities here.
Yeah, we're going Fear and Loathing style, bro. We rented a Cadillac.
Like an Escalade?
I don't know. Cadillac sports car or something. Holy we got to go pick it up. We're going to fucking cruise the
God
desert.
Damn,
like,
We're going. I'm going to go to Vegas.
We're going. We're going animal style, you know. And Pete takes it easy like me. He's a mellow dude. He only plays a lunatic on TV.
Come on. The hotel where you guys staying, did anyone hook you up with any tickets to other events other than UFC 194?
Yeah, well, we actually coached an executive in the UFC. Pete and I coached one of his an executive's son, and he's offered to give us tickets to the Ultimate Fighter finale. So we're gonna go to that on Friday night as well.
God damn!
Yeah. Wait, hold on a second. Yeah. Paige and Sage?
No, that's tonight. That's tomorrow night. There's three nights in a row, bro.
Oh my god! After you were gonna see Paige, I was
no.
Gonna
it's
die.
Edgar Mendez.
Edgar Mendez.
Oh my
Mendes.
God! In the 25-foot in the 25-foot small cage.
Yeah.
In the small cage.
Yeah.
This is gonna be a legit.
No, it's the same cage that they're using.
No, nope. It's a 25-foot. It's a smaller cage.
They're using both cages.
Yes.
Yeah. Why?
Yeah.
Why? Because it's actually exciting. Because they have to use the big cage the next day.
I would love to see those midgets fight each other in a huge
First of all, that's a horribly offensive word. First of all, that's a horribly offensive word when we're friends with Tyler the Dwarf.
Oh, gosh. I didn't mean that. I'm a fucking idiot. I apologize.
And he just hooked up with, not sexually, he hooked up work-wise with Marty the M.
Marty the little person?
Yes. You know Marty the little guy with the Raiders tattoo, the most badass LP on Earth?
Oh, that dude's crazy.
Before Tyler Holkins. So they're buddies now.
See, I don't even recognize Tyler as a little person. He's a fighter.
Yeah, stand next to him.
You know?
Stand next to him.
He's a fucking mixed martial artist.
Stand next to the guy. Stand next to the guy.
Now who's being a dick?
Hey, his only rule is don't say the M word.
I didn't know that. I apologize.
His manager, when I met him for the interview, they go, I'm just going to tell you straight up. He doesn't give a fuck what you say. If you say the M word, he's going to knock you out. No joke. Like, not a game. He's going to punch you in your fucking mouth. Yeah.
That's well, I apologize. And then I did not mean that.
It's
okay. I'm ignorant.
You're a bigot. It's cool. No, I'm kidding. Okay, so where are you staying? What hotel?
Don't know yet, but we're supposedly staying in a suite that one of his DJ
of
friends
course
is
you are. Of
hooking
course.
Up with.
Jesus.
Okay,
Christ.
So that's incredible. I mean, I can't wait to hear.
I don't do drugs.
Do you? I'm not gonna put you on blast because I don't want to put you. I know you. It's. Man, hangover style. Blow hookers, strippers,
it's good.
Tigers, Mike
no,
Tyson.
No.
Just don't lose those tickets to the UFC night 194.
Oh, geez,
don't party
Luis.
Too hard that you forget.
Is there
about.
A chance you might, if Rockhold wins, that you guys would go hang out with him after?
There's probably a definite, I would say.
And you'll be able to get a post-fight interview for the show.
Yeah, I'd probably talk to him. I'm probably, you know.
But you'll video a post-fight interview for the show.
Oh, is this like do I have to sign like a waiver or something right now? Yeah, I'll do my best to see if I can get some work done while we're there.
Dude, this guy goes. This is every time he goes on a VIP trip like this, he gets no coverage and then comes back and is like, "Dude, I couldn't get anything." And then he's like, "Yeah, I hung out with fucking everyone you could imagine."
Well, first of all, the UFC Expo. I don't know if anybody went to it this year. It was not like the UFC Expo when you went to go to it.
You mean where I got interviews with everyone and their mother, and then when you went to the UFC Expo and got not one single interview.
Dude, they have like
he went
airplane. No,
he
let
went
me finish.
To Vegas to get coverage and got not one thing of coverage.
We Bob shot me going into the expo. That was, it was just like footage of me walking
Did
in.
Really filmed it?
It was so funny, dude. It was so funny because we thought we were gonna get all this footage. He's like, Let me get some entrance work, right? And we get in there. And there's literally like airplane ropes. You know the velvet ropes?
Yeah,
the velvet ropes are like 60 yards.
Nice.
To this.
And
elevated table.
You're media, so you walk to the front of
no,
the line.
No, you had
to
get on the line with everybody else. And we were like, fuck that.
But
no
you're
way.
Media. Don't you just walk up and do the
no,
interview?
No, there was no. You had to wait online.
It was like a customs line?
Yes.
Really?
You didn't walk to the front and just say who you were and do the interview?
he's laughing right now because he knows everybody. I'd be like, hey, I'm fucking Jonathan King from the Clinch Report. And they'd be like, yeah, who?
You're like, I'm the grease man.
Number two, grease man.
Hey, let's talk about Sage Mania. Sage Mania, dude.
I don't understand it.
How do you not understand
it? I'm more interested in his sister. Did you see that? His sister?
Colby.
She hot?
She looks has a body like his, and she fights in MMA as well.
So, oh, yeah. Did you see what his opponent looked like at the weigh-in today?
No.
His opponent had not any muscle at all. Sage comes up. He's twice the size and shredded to the fucking gills. He's Ubereem. He's a 155 Ubereem. He looks like Sean Sherk.
Well,
Shirk.
There's a lot of accusations
he looks like Sean
Shirk. About his dad doing providing steroids. He got caught with steroids a couple years ago. Mm-hmm. But, you know,
Sage
I'm not
it,
saying.
Sage takes it so well, though.
Right,
he takes it complimentary. He says, it's a compliment.
Yeah.
I'm rooting for the kid. I hope the best for him. If he does get in trouble for something, oh well. But I hope the best. I hope the best for him. He's a fresh face.
Do you think
Cody Pfister?
It's kind of hard to get behind a corporate champion. You know what I
mean?
But
he's
like,
so goddamn nice.
He's not a grassroots.
But
the UFC ruined him for me.
No, hold on.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, hold on a second.
Yeah,
hold on.
With it, John.
No, they're doing the opposite. They're not doing the full crazy thing like with Ronda where they throw it in your face. They're doing a fight pass. He's not a main event. They're doing the embeddeds, but the thing
you
is,
you know why they
but,
can't do that.
But he's got it. The thing is, he's a world champion competitor.
Yeah,
he's a world champion competitor.
The reason they can't do that is the difference is, in my opinion, is that Sage weight class is much much deeper, and you know. It's
Plus, he just started at 155
as
well.
Yeah, that's a deep weight class. I mean, you can't just start promoting him, put him in the main event. I mean, the guy. There's so many 155 good fighters, and I've been fighting for a long time.
Who
so.
Was Chris Weidman's first opponent in the UFC? I believe it was Tom Lawler.
Oh really?
Yeah.
Wow.
And this is, I'm not saying anything bad against Cody Pfister, but he's obviously being put out there
He has a great record. He's but a to be really honest, good
fighter, but the UFC body, doesn't want him to win.
It says he's from Team Takedown, but he has like no camp, lives in the boondocks. He's got all the odds against him.
I'm is telling it, you right
better?
Now.
It's yeah. much better.
He's a quiet, soft-spoken dude. Don't sleep on this kid in this
fight. Of course not. But I'm saying that the odds are against him.
Of course. But the Sage, UFC I'm doesn't Sage want him fan. To win, but I have a feeling
I put
that
a Sage.
I can't believe Aaron uses the physique as a variable.
I completely base everything based on weight and physique. Speaking of which, did you see Rose?
Yeah, you were she saying did. She looked really
she
bad,
She looked horrible.
Right?
She looked so drawn Sucked out. Her out? Eyes were bloodshot. She looked just had a horrible. Head. No. Dude, I don't comment on people's looks. God dang it, Adrian, you pig.
Adrian, you're so shallow. Pigs. Whoa, you guys.
Well, you,
what you mean, you people?
I thought, dude, yeah, what's well, up with it?
Okay, I would never, first of all, Rose, I'll tell people. You why I will never comment on Rose's body. I'll tell you why right now. Can I tell you why?
Pat Barry.
One, because I call you the wild card. Pat Barry's a wild card. That guy's crazy as hell. But two, because she always talks about traumatic stuff where she doesn't want to be viewed with her body and body image. So I respect her for her fighting ability, and that's what she wants to be known as. But no, yeah, dude. No,
I agree.
Not,
Pat Barry's the Gary Busey of MMA.
I'm not saying she looked horrible like, physique-wise or like looks-wise. I mean, she looked horrible, like drawn out. Oh, my God.
Like sucked out?
She looked bad, man. Really bad.
And does she have a tough weight cut? She seems like such a small person.
Zombie Prophet on Twitter was saying she looks like I don't want to misquote you, bro. If you listen to this, I'm sorry if I misquote you. He was basically saying it looks like she just got like a concentration camp or like our people. No, he didn't say defensively like that. I'm Jewish, so trust me, it wasn't offensive.
Down.
He said she just got like a war camp or offsides. Or that like 33 days in the Chilean mine. Like no, I'm just the point is what I'm trying to make.
Offsides. We got holding.
No, the point I'm trying to make is clipping. That he agreed she didn't look good. She didn't look good.
Yeah, no, I saw some of the pictures. I didn't watch the weigh-ins, but
she looked amazing during her open workout. She looked really good.
I hope I'm wrong. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe she just had a cold.
I think the biggest thing that I saw today was the face-off between Aldo and Connor.
Did they get physical?
No, I didn't get physical. But the funny thing is, Connor used a different stance. You know, he used his orthodox stance. So he was. I don't know if he's
maybe it was the picture of the side they're on.
No. He purposely did it. I think to fuck with
because he doesn't want Aldo to get the range.
Yeah, well, he's just. I think he's. Just
okay. Listen to this too. And man, no, this is rude though because we're having Dr. Anne Marie on, but this is a true comparison. This is a damn true comparison. Conor McGregor's movement coach, you know him doing those stupid movement things?
Yeah.
People around everywhere now going to gyms, you see them doing the stupid movement crap. It's almost like Ronda when she was doing the judo bands.
Oh, yeah.
Where it's like this hocus pocus where they think this is a mysterious, mythical movement that's going to win him the UFC championship. The movement thing is garbage.
Well,
it's garbage.
I know why Ronda did it. That's a judo.
No. But I'm saying like people like posting gifs like because of the movement. You know that's how you become a champion. I'm trying to say is. Like,
I don't know about that.
I don't know. Yeah. I don't think I'm explaining it right. I don't think I'm putting it in the right.
Actually,
words,
I hear all the MMA camps, American Top Team, all the big ones, AKA. They're now bringing in the Mountain from Game of Thrones to spar with everybody.
Okay, first of all,
to help.
First of
to
all,
help with technique. So, Conor McGregor, you are a fucking trendsetter in MMA. Let me tell you.
First of all, that's totally an old video because he doesn't have a stomach tattoo of the tiger on that. So everyone's trying to make it look like that's
good some observation.
Just like with me with the Ronda video where everyone claims it was the week of the fight and then it's like, no, that was actually done before the Misha fight.
And easy fella, if that guy got a hold of your head and was really trying to rip your head off, Connor.
Oh no, Connor could take that guy. Connor could take that guy.
No, but he had the guy had him in a headlock. Yeah, and he was like, he was trying to rip my head off. I'm like, if he was trying to rip your head off, you wouldn't have a head.
No. Connor sat him down like the rest of them. It was Red Pandy night. He sat him down like the rest. It had 10 million views. He should have got show money. He should have got paid his show.
Do you remember how
3 minutes till K-Flow, by the way.
Do you remember how we were talking about how hard it's going to be for Ronda to come back with all the bravado that she had and everything?
I don't know if she's going to come back. We're going to have to ask Doctor today. Doctor tonight.
How hard do you think it's going to be for them to build up Aldo or McGregor if he loses badly?
I don't think it will be either win because it will be a problem because both has a championship belt. They could easily do a rematch. Or Connor.
How dare you say
or,
they both have a championship belt?
Or Connor's going to go up to 155 after this fight anyway, regardless.
Yeah.
So, yeah. To be honest, I think that both of these guys are so marketable. Jose, whatever, hasn't lost in 10 years.
See, that's not the way I do it. I would try to rebuild him back in a rematch with Holloway. Because if Holloway wins, then him and Holloway had a real close fight. And then you could build Connor again for another title shot after that.
Connor, he's marketable. He can trust me. He's marketable regardless. I don't think it's a lose-lose either way. Man, what do you think about your opinion, Paige versus Rose? Because people are saying Rose is so much more skilled, but she looks so bad at the weigh-ins. And Paige isn't a joke. She has an incredible camp. I think Paige has better sparring partners, I think Paige has better sparring partners, but Rose has incredible coaching. Trevor Whitman is a genius. That guy is such a. But do you think they negate each other, the camps? Because they're two top level camps. I mean, Whitman's incredible. Faber's alpha male team is incredible.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I mean, you know, that's one of the variables that I consider whenever I see two fighters going, you know, up to fight. Exactly. Whatever. But I don't know if this makes really a difference. I think that, you know, I'm excited to see this fight. I personally think that, we might do predictions later, so I won't say who I think is going to win. But it's, you know, they can go anywhere. I believe they're both scrappy and they can both go to the ground and it'll be a good fight either way. So
I'm looking forward to this one. And, you know, I'm really high on Thug Rose. I think she's got a lot of potential. She's all potential, that kid. And I know everybody's hyping up Paige VanZant, but the way most people feel about Paige VanZant now, that's the way I've kind of felt about Rose Namajunas for a while. She's a superior athletic young lady. She's unbelievable at bringing the fight, transitioning the fight from the stand up to the ground, those flying arm bars. She can do so much and from so many different positions. I just think experience is on her side in this fight.
I'm curious to see, because Paige VanZant is a little bit more aggressive, you know, and I'm curious to see if Rose is going to counter that or if she's going to, you know, just like in some ways Ronda was with Holly, right? I'm wondering if that's going to be the game plan for.
Well, everyone says that Rose is more experienced. She's 4-2. Paige, I think, has equal or more fights and had AMI fights.
Did Rose do a Muay Thai, though, or?
That's possible. Yeah, you're right. Been doing martial arts, and she's kind of a more natural athlete, even though Paige is a great dancer. We've got Kenny Florian coming on soon. Did you hear about Bob Sapp? Oh, God, there's Kenny Florian right now. Call coming in from Massachusetts. Adrian, take this call.
Oh, I am so excited.
I'm too nervous. I can't do it, guys.
This is amazing. Yeah, let's just quit. Can't do it. Kenny's too cool for us.
Oh, man.
Host of the UFC tonight. This is amazing. We have a hell of a good night tonight, man.
All right, guys. I think it's time to welcome our first guest of the night, a man who really needs no introduction, but I love doing intros, so I'm definitely going to give him one. Ladies and gentlemen, we are now welcoming to the show UFC legend, a man who's performed in 4 weight classes, had title fights in multiple weight classes, a graduate and former varsity soccer player at the, I think, Boston University. Ladies and gentlemen, Kenny, K-Flo, Florian, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much. It was Boston College, not Boston University, but all right, man. It was good. I forgive you.
That was pretty close.
That was one of his better introductions.
Dang, that was pretty close. That was off the top of the head pretty close.
It's on the same street, so I totally get it.
All right, well, Kenny, this is Aaron Shrew. I'm joined by your buddy Jonathan King and also Adrian Gallegos. Kenny, your last fight was against Jose Aldo. You're tall. You're a southpaw. So I was thinking about it, and I was thinking you're pretty close to a Conor McGregor in terms of, you know, the body size, probably taller. Are you pretty much the perfect style or person to study your fight against Aldo for Conor?
Go ahead.
Oh, no, do you think that you're a similar fighter in terms of style or size or being a southpaw to Conor? Do you think that you would have a lot of similarities that fight versus the fight you had?
I mean, there's some similarities, but I think Conor McGregor, if I'm being completely honest, is a far better striker than I was back then in 2011, and I learned a lot from that fight. And the other thing is why I ended up picking Conor McGregor is the fact that I felt like I was able to keep the fight against Jose Aldo relatively close, despite having the worst weight cut of my life. And you know, I think with good tactics, with patience, with a good breakdown, and the ability to feel the fight, I think Conor McGregor has a good chance. Now, both these men are so capable, so dangerous, have so many weapons, and their skill level is truly world-class. I think really anything can happen, but I think the style of McGregor is different than mine in that he moves in a different rhythm, and he also has a different variety of skills than I had back then. And I think he's just a very tricky fighter, and I'm sure he's going to be using a lot of spinning attacks against Jose Aldo, something that I really didn't do.
Okay. And, you know, you trained at TriStar. You trained with Mark Delagrade. Hopefully I got that right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And, you know, there's multiple gyms, and you cross-trained a lot. Later on tonight, we have on, as our second guest, Dr. Anne Marie DeMars, Ronda Rousey's mother. And we're going to ask her, do you think that Ronda only being at one gym has limited her growth? You know, you're a guy who, you're smart enough to know you had to go to different places, get different things, and have multiple areas of expertise. Actually, you're an incredible example of that. Just the way you progress throughout your career, we'll get to that later on. But do you think that it's important to stay at one place, or do you really need to evolve and adapt and learn from new places and new gyms to be successful?
I think there's tremendous danger in being complacent in anything you do. Anytime you get comfortable with a particular mindset, with a particular type of training, you can set yourself up for failure. You know, when you talk about the elite guys, you have to be doing something different than everybody else, you know. And I think that's the key. In any kind of combat, if you're not getting better, you're getting worse. And that goes, you know, you look at anything from, you know, the military at an elite level. If the technology isn't up to par, or people aren't kind of ever, for people forgetting about kind of old certain skills, there's always going to be a weakness. And if you're not working on everything, then you're really at a big disadvantage. So I think you need, if you are staying at one school, you can get better by bringing in a variety of different sparring partners, but that isn't always challenging either, because you're just in that same gym all the time where you're most comfortable. Going to a different gym all the time for me always gave me butterflies, and always kind of gave me that, not the same feeling as a fight, but definitely it was a different sense as I was training with different guys and new people all the time.
It takes humility, I think, in a sense, because I was thinking about this on the way over here when I was asking you the question. And when I go to a gym, like say Kings MMA or just wherever, or people invite me to jiu-jitsu gyms or different gyms all the time, and it's nerve-wracking because I know they're going to want to kick my ass, they're going to want to beat me up, and I'm going to have to go in there with humility and get beat up, basically.
Yeah, you got
to
run the gauntlet every time you go into a new gym. And it kind of keeps,
it's not
like Kenny
easy.
Says, it keeps
it's
you on
easy.
Your toes, you know?
Yeah.
There's no doubt, because even like let's say I would train with George St. Pierre on a regular basis. And as good as George St. Pierre is, over time, I understood of where George was good, and I knew kind of how to avoid certain things against him. So that, in a sense, made me comfortable. Yes, I was sparring with, you know, the best guy in the world at 170 pounds, but after doing it so much, there wasn't any sense of nervousness after a while. George was my friend. It's someone I'm comfortable with. I was able to figure him out just a little bit. So I was way more comfortable sparring George St. Pierre than I would be a guy coming off the street at 155 pounds, for example, that had a style that I was, you know, I had no idea what he was going to do to me. So it's always good to bring in fresh guys, different styles, different people.
Kenny, you were coming out of the Ultimate Fighter, you were kind of earlier in your career, you were kind of a quiet fighter who did most of his talking in the cage. And as your career progressed, I mean, one of my favorite lines ever is the I finish fights. You realized, you know, you realized you got to sell yourself, and you got to sell. It's a game. It's a marketing. Coming into this fight, we have a guy who is a master at selling himself, Conor McGregor. He has this psychology where he's going to get in Aldo's head, and he's kind of like this clown prince of MMA, but he's got the talent to back it up, no doubt. On the other side, you have Aldo, who's just staring at him like he's, pardon my French, like he's a fucking psycho killer.
Right.
You know, going into this fight, which psychology, where does the needle go on the psychology thermometer? Is it going towards Aldo's psycho killer, or does it play into the favor of the clown prince of MMA, Conor McGregor?
You know, it's really hard to tell because, you know, Jose Aldo is kind of this machine that really doesn't get too emotional. Now, I think if we're looking at the psychology of things, Conor McGregor has been the same throughout his career, really. I mean, the first fight when he came onto the scene, he was a little brash, he was confident, maybe on the cocky side, but we didn't really see this come out until a little bit later, maybe his second, third fight, but he's been pretty consistent throughout his career. Jose Aldo has been the same as well, up until this fight. He has showed emotions that he's never shown before. We saw him get overly excited in a lot of these stare downs that they've had over the last year. And it's hard to get something like that out of your head. As a fighter, when you have a guy that is talking a lot of trash, you're going to be thinking about him a lot. And when you're talking about country versus country, Brazil versus Ireland, you know, the buildup that's been happening for a long time, it's been building up for over a year. Conor McGregor has insulted his country, has insulted his coach, has insulted his team, has insulted him as a champion. And we've seen Aldo kind of get out of his normal mode. So I think if there's a winner in here, I think the pressure is really mounting on Jose Aldo. He even said in one of the embeds that if he loses this fight, everything that he's worked up into this point is for nothing. That's a lot. That's a lot of pressure.
Wow, that is. That's crazy. So you said earlier that you're thinking you're leaning towards, you picked McGregor in this fight. Am I correct?
Yes, I'm leaning towards McGregor.
Okay.
And how do you, I'm just curious, how do you picture it rolling out? Is it a finish or?
I don't see this fight going the distance either way. If it's Aldo or McGregor or whatever, I just don't see it going the distance. McGregor pressures you. He forces you to fight. And that also kind of tends to bring out the best in Aldo. We've seen when you start taking the fight to Aldo, Aldo takes it up a notch. If you go out there and kind of try to play it very strategic against someone like Aldo, he has a tendency of cruising a little bit. He does just enough to kind of outpoint you and win the fight. He's that talented where he kind of can do that. Now, McGregor, everything he does is a style to put a lot of pressure on you and force you to fight. And I think that's going to bring out the nastiness in Jose Aldo, and one of these guys are going to get knocked out.
Okay. Yeah. All right, well, K-Flo, I have a question, actually kind of more of a comment before we get to rapid fire, some of your predictions. I've got to just throw this out there. I've always wanted to say this to you. To be a K-Flo fan, you've got to be a fan of something else as well, because it's something you're going to deal with every time he fights. What is it like to have Keith Florian as your cornerman?
That's funny. You know, just growing up with Keith, man, you know, it was a trip. He's been one of the most intense people I've ever met in my life, and he's been my training partner since day one. And, you know, one thing is for sure, that you are going to hear him in your corner. That is for sure. My brother is maybe got the loudest pipes in the game.
Well, I always joke as annoying as it sounds and seems, if you're in the cage, yeah, wouldn't you want that? Because people always say you can't hear your corner guy. Is it comforting, distracting, or what? Or is it indifferent?
No, definitely. I mean, Keith, you know, if I needed to hear something, I knew
I needed
to hear
something. Come on, Kenny! You gotta go! You gotta go now, Kenny!
20,000 people yelling, and I hear my brother. That's for sure.
That's awesome.
That's amazing. Thanks for answering. I've always just as a longtime fan, it's just that was one of my favorite parts of when watching you fight. I'd always tell my dad or whoever you're watching with, I'm like, trust me, you be ready for the corner guy. It's gonna be amazing. Well, Kenny, let me ask you rapid fire. You can ask rapid fire. Who you think will win. You don't have to really elaborate if you don't want to go into depth.
Okay. Cool.
Paige VanZant versus Thug Rose.
I'm going with Rose Namajunas.
Okay. And then Aldo McGregor. You went with McGregor, it sounds like.
Yes.
All right. Weidman versus Rockhold.
So I think Weidman is going to get it done. I think Weidman is just a beast, and I just think his wrestling is going to be the difference. So Weidman.
Okay. And then, man, ever since a 145-pound weigh-in day K-Flow, we have never seen such a sight as Super Sage. Super Sage Northcutt. Oh, my gosh. So Super Sage versus Cody Pfister. Who do you think? Or Pfister.
Pfister versus Sage. I think Northcutt. I don't think this is an easy fight. You know, they're not just handing them fights. Pfister is tough. He's very game.
I agree.
But I think Northcutt will get it done. I think he'll be able to get the finish either the second or the third.
Okay, and then before I get to my co-host, Jonathan King has a question for you. I've got to bust his balls real quick with one more question. I've got to do it. Kenny, what is it like to share the screen with Jonathan King? The man that they say is the best the best grease man since Rocky, the movie Rocky, Mickey, the cut man. What is it like? How do you not let this guy steal each scene you're in? How do you get any screen time?
I hate you. I hate you so much. Well, I'm actually hoping that, Kenny, I could text you next time that I wear a suit on set so you could, like, wear something that's not the best-looking suit that God himself created. Because every time I show up, I think I'm the best-looking guy on set, and then you show up, and I'm like, God damn it.
Oh, stop. You were killing it last time I saw you.
My question, though, is we forgot one fight, and to me, this is the most intriguing fight of the weekend. Because it sets the table for the 145-pound division.
Mendez-Edgar.
Mendez versus Frankie Edgar. In my opinion, I think Frankie Edgar is the true top of the division. And that's just my point. Well, who do you have in that one?
You know, I mean, this is a fight that I've been looking forward to for a long time. Two very similar fighters going at it. The difference for me is the fact that Frankie Edgar just puts together everything so well. He puts everything together very well, and he just throws more volume than Chad Mendez. Mendez has maybe more power than Frankie, but I think Frankie, the way that he puts his combinations together, how active he is, he just throws so much at you. Even when he's not doing anything, even when he's not striking, he's moving, he's feinting, he's trying to find an angle, always working, and because of that, I think Frankie gets it done.
Okay, and we know your time is valuable, so there's just a couple more things before we wrap up. Jonathan, do you have any more questions?
No, I'm good.
Okay, well, I have one. What was it like, what did it feel like getting a leg kick from Jose Aldo?
It's not cute, man, I'll tell you that. He hit me in the leg about five or six times, and, you know, I've said this on multiple occasions, but I didn't get the feeling back in my leg for about 2 months, maybe 2.5 months. It's the hardest I've ever been hit, period. It's certainly the hardest I've ever been kicked. And it's one of those things, too, because you can't really prepare for his kind of speed. And that's one thing that Conor's going to have to really adjust to and nullify very early on. The speed of Jose Aldo is something you can't prepare for until you're actually in there with him. It's mind-boggling how fast he is.
Well, what about Conor's movement coach? You don't think that will be effective?
Well, not against the leg. I mean, it might. I don't know. I don't know against something like a leg kick. I mean, he's going to have to be very flexible and be able to move in and out. But once you get kicked like that, it doesn't matter what kind of movement coach you have. You're not going to be able to move the same.
Yeah, I think it's going to be about the straight left hand and the leg kicks this whole fight. It's going to be who lands which one first.
Kenny,
And the left hook of Aldo as well.
Yeah.
Kenny, this is Adrian. I was just going to ask really quick, you know, what makes Jose Aldo so effective? Is it just the speed and the power, or is it one favors over the other?
You know, he does all the little things, all the things that you can't quite see, he does so well. So, you know, his fundamentals, his ability to just always be in the perfect range at the right time. Is what makes him so good. And, you know, his distance control, and then you add in all his athleticism with his speed and his explosiveness, his ability to read takedowns. You know, there's a reason why he's been undefeated for 10 years. He has an excellent mind. He's a very smart fighter. He just knows how to win rounds, and he also knows how to finish fights.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, we're talking to not only just the host of UFC programming, not just a commentator for UFC programming. He's also one of the co-hosts of At Anik Florian Podcast, At Anik Florian POD. When can we hear your podcast?
Thanks, man. We are on SoundCloud and iTunes. We do a podcast, Anik and I do it every Monday, and I appreciate everyone checking it out.
We really appreciate your time tonight, Kenny. Honestly, I know we kind of busted chops and had a lot of fun. And dude, you're a class act. Jonathan King always says nonstop, you're his favorite fighter. Always talks so highly of you. And I have your UFC doll. I've actually tweeted you. I don't know if you remember, but my baby niece loves your UFC action figure. And it's the only thing that keeps her quiet, and she loves the doll. So I tweeted that to you one time, and you responded, I think, or retweeted it.
You guys rock, man. But I got to say, don't trust a damn thing that Jonathan King says. He's a liar. Don't trust him. So.
Awesome. Kenny, thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, UFC legend, Kenny K-Flo Florian.
All right, man. Thanks, Kenny.
Kenny.
Thank you, guys.
That guy's awesome, dude.
That was a lot of fun. That was just what we needed, you know. I feel so good and like hyped up, a lot of energy coming off of that. That was a lot of fun. That was exactly what we needed, something fun like that. What a class act.
Like one of the reasons I'm such a fan of the guys is just listen to his analysis. His analysis of Jose Aldo. You know, I'm in here thinking Jose. It's going to be straight left hand.
I say it both, Jose, Jose. I say it both because I always forget which one it is.
He says it's not just about the straight left hand and from McGregor and the leg kicks from Aldo. It's also about Aldo's left hooks. It's also that Aldo knows how to do all of the little things.
Technical.
The stuff that you don't recognize. He finds a way to win. Not only rounds,
plus,
fights.
He's been in, I think he has the longest average fight in the featherweight division, and Conor's never been past the second round, or maybe only has been once, or whatever it is. So, Jose, however you want to say it, which is the right way, which I don't know.
I don't know either.
I always forget. I don't know why I'm on
it's Jose.
Is it Jose? Exactly. So, I was saying it right.
Okay.
Yeah. Jose. So, Jose Aldo, he has the longest fight average, the whole division. He's game tested.
Well, that's what Kenny said. He sometimes he puts his foot. There that's was why about he's five for breaks. 10 years. There was about five fights back. When Jose Aldo was putting together Jose was putting together some lackluster performances, you know?
Yeah.
And I don't think it was because he was out of shape or anything. I think it was because he didn't have to.
Yeah, you know what?
He simply does enough to win and keep himself out of trouble, and that's what a good champion does.
I think, you know? the biggest thing that I heard from Kenny was that, you know, it depends on if you put the pressure on him. He arises to the occasion.
Exactly,
right?
Yeah.
And that's something that might explain some of the fights that went to decision, that he was just coasting by. Cause like you said, he didn't have to. But, you know, if the fighter brings it to him, then he's going to elevate, and he has been elevating for the last 10 years, right?
I can't believe I forgot the Mendez-Egger fight on my list.
That's
with
okay.
All my
that's
preparation.
Why I got you back, bro.
Thank you. After all the shit I talk.
But
it's because I was so distracted after I wrote Sage versus Fister. I just kept thinking about Sage. And I was like, damn, Sage, you think you know how hot he is normally?
You're just
have
stuck
you
in
seen
his
Weigh-In
ass.
Day?
Yeah.
He didn't. Honestly, I like regular day Sage over Weigh-In Day Sage.
Really?
Yeah. Weigh-In Day Sage was, you know, when like Baroni, you get those veins down on your hips. Too much for me. Too much. Oh. I don't like the veiny hips.
I got to say, you know, normally I don't ask questions to the guests, but
I love when you do.
But I gotta say, Kenny was like so easygoing.
And yeah,
it felt like I didn't feel like you know, like I'm always a guy behind the scenes, and I don't get starstruck. Real like, I mean, I won't talk to them, but I just don't get starstruck. But usually, I don't talk to them because I'm afraid what I'm gonna say. But with Kenny, it was so comfortable, I guess, you know. So
and I always have questions where, depending on the guest, their attitude and how it's going. They may not know I'm joking with them.
Right, yeah.
But I knew he knew.
Yeah, yeah,
no,
yeah.
We're having fun.
Yeah.
That's why I could ask about Keith, because you knew, dude, I always.
He was
I
laughing
you know
as you
me.
Started asking
yeah,
the question.
He knew
man.
It was coming.
Oh, yeah.
Because if you're an old school fan, if you're watching Kenny Florian fight, oh, my God. You got to go now, Kenny.
Well, you mentioned Baroni, too. He's another one.
I was going to ask, but
screams.
He already gave such a great sound, but I was going to say Baroni versus Keith. Yeah. But that would be the ultimate. I think Keith is a better technical corner man.
I think for a 5-round fight, there'd probably be about 6 words shouted between the two of them. So
they have like a throat surgeon on standby. Yeah, what a great interview. That was a lot of fun. Well, is there anything else you guys want to talk about before we go into our next guest? Or
Let me just check to see if she's calling.
Okay. All right. So
who do you have for?
We should introduce who the next guest is.
Yeah, but who do you have for Mendez versus Edgar?
No. Man. That's a tough call. This is exactly what you were saying earlier, where it used to be where old school, you knew who was going to win. You could make an educated guess as an expert, but now it's so much more equal. It's tough. Guys are experts in different variables. They're so well-rounded. Man, it's a tough fight. And I know you love Frankie. I'm not a Frankie fan. I kind of like Mendez.
You like Mendez? That's
damn.
Your pick, man.
But Edgar is unbeatable.
Yeah.
Outside of title shots, Edgar is freaking unbeatable.
He doesn't lose fights.
I know. I mean,
so you got Mendez?
I want Mendez to win, but if you put if I had to put money on it, I mean, shit. That's why this is why MMA. Why right now it's a different stage because it's a coin flip.
Right.
I don't know. I mean, the only fights that Mendez loses is title fights.
See, this is
the only fights Edgar's ever lost is a title fight.
This is the time to fight. This matchup.
I'm going Edgar. If I had to bet money, I'd go Edgar.
Is the perfect matchup to listen to like Florian and Anik on their podcast because they are so scientific about breaking down well, the different matchups and stuff like that.
Yeah, but it's like
I agree with Kenny on this one. Edgar, his movement and I think Chad's power.
Shout out to my buddy Dave, by the way. Watching the show says it's going great. Thanks, Dave.
Mendez does have a slight power advantage.
And shout out to my nephew Jack.
But this is the first time Mendez is coming up against a better wrestler in MMA in a long time.
Well, yeah, but here's the thing. Mendez has, I'd say, KO power. Frankie has tighter boxing, but I think Mendez has knockout power, which is variable. And Frankie's been caught by big punches by Gray Maynard.
Yeah, but Gray Maynard's slower though. So
it's like you said, Mendez is going against a guy who's well rounded. Frankie can box, he can wrestle, he can go five rounds and then another five.
How often,
and then another five?
How often do you see Frankie on his back? It's very rare, right? So
he proves endurance. Right. Where
Henderson was the only time I saw him often on his back.
Well, Henderson's so freaking big. Yeah. Henderson now Henderson's at 170 and Frankie's at 145.
Yeah. Frankie didn't even cut weight to fight at 155.
I see it being Edgar and I'm nothing against Chad. I think Chad's a hell of an athlete. I think it's Edgar's time.
Yeah, I agree.
And I think
Edgar's
it's going to be
so
in the first round, and I think it's going to be nasty.
Wow, we're going to put you on record, nasty in the first round.
Nasty, you not.
That's round. Him. No, that's him, not me.
Yeah, I think
you got second round.
I think
I'm going for
dude, Frankie Edgar.
I'm going Edgar by decision.
Frankie
He's not going to finish the fight.
East Coast
Edgar's
boy from New York.
Fight.
When you step on an East Coast boy from New Jersey, New York, and you push them down and push them down and tell them, no, it's not your turn yet. It's not your turn yet. It's not your turn yet. When the light hits them, oh my God, do they shine?
You're talking Jersey Shore affliction.
No. I'm not talking
you're talking,
idiots. I'm not talking to potato parts.
Is this a shirt off? Is that what
I'm
you're saying?
You're talking about when Frankie was Frankie, when Ronnie from Jersey Shore is wearing the Frankie affliction shirt on Jersey Shore, that's when Frankie was the man.
Can I go Anderson?
I know. I'm trying to just trolling the hell out of you. Okay. So, ladies and gentlemen, we have an amazing treat coming up here.
Oh, this is
I
awesome.
Think Dr. Anne Marie DeMarge is calling in. Adrian, do we have a guest on the line here?
Yeah.
Okay. What's bringing the call? Ladies and gentlemen, we have an absolute treat for you tonight. We have on Dr. Anne Marie DeMars. Dr. Anne Marie, you are here with Aaron, Jonathan, and Adrian. Thank you so much for joining us tonight.
You're very welcome.
Well, first of all, our first question is, we were looking at your biography, and you are extremely well-traveled, well-studied. You have several degrees at multiple universities all over the world. So it seems like evolving and growing and continuing to learn, that's a major part of your life. Do you think that do you think that Rhonda staying stagnant at one gym is hurting her from growing and improving?
Well, I think for anybody, not just Rhonda, it's funny. Years ago, I was talking to a good friend of mine, and we'd been on the world team together, and we kind of went through some people that we thought had really great potential and didn't make it. And, you know, they did well, but they didn't go as well as we thought. And I said, Mike Swain, I don't know if you know who he is, but he was the first man to win the world championships from the U.S. in judo. And I said, I mean, Mike's a good judo player, but I had thought there would be other people before him that would win. And I asked my friend, you know, why she thought, because there were some people from her gym, and she said, you know, because they stayed where they were comfortable. And Mike went to Japan. He was from New Jersey originally. He went to San Jose State. He went all around the world, literally, trying to get better. And I think for anybody, that's whether you're in sports or in business or, in academics, nobody has all the answers, and you're always going to be better off if you learn from more than one person and you go to more than one place. I think that's true for everybody in just about every endeavor.
Is that something that you're skeptical about Rhonda's current coach, that he tends to think that he has all the answers? Is that something that immediately rubs you the wrong way?
There are many things, but I think one of them, I mean, I've been in business for many years, and I believe that a major part of success in business is ethics and honesty. And, you know, here's somebody who's being investigated for tax fraud, being investigated for mortgage fraud, being investigated for bankruptcy fraud, claims he made no money. I mean, you know, claims he's never had to pay taxes. And I just think that's no way to run a business. And anyone who thinks it is, is delusional. You know, I'm out here in North Dakota right now, and the reason I'm out here is I'm meeting with people from a federal program, and in fact, I met with a few people from federally funded programs, and you may think you're getting away with something, and this is just good advice for anybody in general. You may think you're getting away with something as far as like not paying your taxes or hiding assets, but very often you aren't. Just coincidentally, today on this very small town where I happen to be working, they came in and did some major drug bust and arrested something like 36 people. Jeez. So you may think you're getting away with something, but often what's happening is people are collecting evidence. And I know it's a cliche to say that honesty is the best policy, but I think it is. And, you know, if you're a person who's being investigated for multiple counts of fraud and tax evasion, that's somebody to avoid. And, you know, I try in my entire life to be the diametric opposite of that. You know, I pay corporate taxes and I have a Santa Monica business license. I have a Spirit Lake Tribe business license because I do business out here. I do pay taxes in every state that we do business. I mean, to me, that's just common sense. I mean, unless you're brain dead, you don't think that you can get away with not paying taxes and claiming you have no income and not paying your creditors. I mean, no one runs a business that way. I don't.
Yeah, the investigation, the documents that I saw are pretty intense. They go back a long way. They question pretty much every affiliation that he has. And I guess I got to ask you, are you as a mother, are you a little bit worried that perhaps the investigation might stem to your daughter as well, since obviously she's got to be one of his biggest earners?
Actually, I would say no. One thing, I know Rhonda better than most people, obviously. And not only is she a really good person, but she's often very underestimated as far as how bright she is. And she is pretty good about the very first thing, what check she writes is to the IRS. And the very second check she writes is to her 401k. So she's pretty well on the straight and narrow.
Oh, like, no, I didn't mean with the IRS. I meant in the investigation of Edmund, since she's got to be paying him and he's claiming that he has no income. It could go to her, couldn't it not?
Well, no, because I could tell you a little bit about business, having been in business a long time, and I hire a lot of contractors. So let's say I hire your show to do a commercial for me, and I give a check to your show. And let's say you've produced it, you did all the work on it, and you get paid by them, but you claim no income. Well, I wrote a check to the show, and I declared that check to the show on my taxes, and either you're an idiot or your producer's an idiot or whatever, but as far as I'm concerned, as far as tax laws are concerned and everything else, I'm on the side of the angels. I did my bit. I wrote a check. I declared on my taxes. I showed on my, you know, bank statement, my profit and loss. So if you claim you have no income, then you're an idiot.
Yeah.
Like, that's not my problem.
All right, well, Doctor, we have another question for you. Much like Rhonda being the first female UFC champion, you were the first person, man or woman, from the U.S. to win a world championship in judo. So you kind of know what it's like to have the pressure of being the first to accomplish a major thing in terms of combat sports. Part of being a champion is never giving up, never quitting. You fall, you get right back up, and you never quit. That's how, obviously, you become a champion. People are saying Ronda's going to retire. This is it. She's done. But as a world champion, you know, as a UFC champion, as an Olympian, is there any way possible she would ever quit, you know, at this point after one defeat?
Well, I don't. I mean, right at the moment, obviously, she's on a, what do they call it, a medical suspension or something. So at the moot point, right?
Right.
And I think, but for me, no, I disagree with that. Actually, a really good friend of mine, Steve Sack, who was on the Olympic team in 1980, gave me really good advice after I won the world championships. He said, no matter what you do, it won't satisfy people. You can win the Olympics, and people will say, could she win it again? He said, you could win the Olympics by all opponents, which is the judo equivalent of knockout. People would say, well, could you win it then under a minute? No matter what you do, people will criticize and be dissatisfied, and so you have to decide when's the time for you. And actually, I didn't go to the Olympics. I had two more kids after I won the world championships. I had Jennifer and then Rhonda, and I didn't go to the 88 Olympics. I went and got a PhD and married Ron Rousey, and that's what I did. And I have never regretted it for a fraction of a second. I think every individual person needs to know when is their time. And, you know, I don't think you can say that for anybody else, that you need to look in the mirror. And I have to tell you, for myself personally, I wanted to win the world championships. I wanted to be best in the world. Nobody had ever done it. And when I did it, I was done. And, you know, to be honest, I didn't have that same thing that I will kill you and eat you in front of the referee if that's what it takes to win. You know, I had done what I wanted to do, and then I went on, did other things, and married the man of my dreams, and got a doctorate and started a business. And I think that advice from Steve was very profound. You know, he did the same thing. He made the Olympic team in 1980, and you might remember we boycotted the Olympics, so he didn't get to go. And then the next time around in 84, Mike Swain, who ended up winning the world, beat Steve, and Steve was the alternate. And at that point, I think he just decided he didn't want to make another run at it. He went and got a master's degree. He's had a good career. And so, no, I think that's a big myth. And I think the exact opposite, that one of the mistakes people make is they don't know when to quit. I've been in combat sports the vast majority of my life. I started competing in judo 45 years ago. And I competed for 14 years. I won at all levels. I coached at everything from little, you know, preschool kids to people who, you know, won international medals. And I see a big mistake where people don't quit because they have nothing else. I remember a guy I knew was just an amazing judo player. He'd won 7 national championships. And afterwards, you know, years, I was at a tournament, international tournament, me and some of my friends were talking, and I said what a great judo player he was, and one of the guys said, are you kidding me? That guy? I've never seen him win. And I realized, yeah, because he had just kept competing and competing because he had nothing else. So, I mean, this isn't anything specific to Rhonda, it's anybody. I think that's a big myth. I think you need to know when it's not what you want to do anymore, and you don't owe your life to anybody else. I think the world is full of people who are living someone else's life.
Well,
sorry
to interrupt you, but one of my friends, Bob Lou Sobral, always says, you don't choose fighting. Fighting chooses you. So it's tough to know when to quit because they're doing it kind of for themselves. It's not really to impress someone else. You know, it's just something inside of them.
Well, until there isn't. You know, Gary Stretch, who was the world boxing champion, said something really brilliant to me one time, too. He said, it's hard to get up and train when you slept in silk pajamas. And his point was, and like I said, Gary was a world champion, that you want to fight to prove something. You want to fight because you're angry. I mean, everybody has their own reason to fight. But sometimes that reason that brings you so much success, then you don't have it anymore. And, you know, it's funny you were saying, because I was just thinking about that, you know, professionally. You know, my whole life I worried about making enough money and building a business and getting a reputation and getting business. And now, you know, I turn business away, and it's kind of weird to not have that same thing to prove, by God, that I'm competent and I can do it. You know, one of my clients is just a wonderful person. I was talking to him. I said, you know, you don't have to renew this contract. It won't hurt my feelings if you want to get, you know, somebody more local or somebody cheaper.
Right.
And he said, no, I already told people my plan is to keep renewing your contract until you either refuse to do it anymore or die. So it is kind of a weird thing. Success is a weird thing. And I say this as somebody who's achieved success in sports and academics and business on a hard road, that you fight and fight and fight to get there, and then you're there. And it's kind of weird. I hope that makes sense.
Yeah. It does. Yeah, that absolutely was actually great, really well put. Yeah, it's... I really love the way how you explain that so eloquently, and you don't just tell us, no, you're wrong. You explain it. You explain it where I was like, wow, I'm having an epiphany during this. This is no wonder she has all these degrees and, you know, she's a doctor.
Yeah, I got to tell you, we have a couple mutual friends. I was told by Dr. Roddy Ferguson.
Awesome.
Yeah, I got to tell the Home Depot takedown. When we worked together at Home Depot, he caught a thief. And
oh, my gosh, yes.
Awesome. Oh, really?
Oh, it was great, yeah.
So that's a true story.
Oh, okay. Yeah, and also Jean LaBelle, who's a near and dear friend of mine, told me, you got to listen to this lady. And I can't wait to read your book, but I got to ask you, you know, I get this sense. There was a lot of noise before the last fight, of course, with Edmund, the controversy with your statements towards Edmund, Rhonda and Travis, their relationship came out in the press, and frankly, it's really nobody's business, but it became a big deal. And I got to ask you, it seemed to me that you kind of had a sense that something was wrong before this fight. Am I right on that? Did you kind of have an idea that maybe, as a motherly instinct, something's not right here?
Well, it's not a motherly instinct. I mean, I have been, like I said, I started judo in 1971, okay? Wow. So, and I wrote a book on it, and I won a world championships, and the world championships wasn't the only international tournament I won. So I know a little bit about this stuff.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely.
And I don't believe that training only at one place is good. I don't believe that not taking advantage of all of the training partners and the resources you can is good. I think anybody who tries to keep other people away from you who could benefit you is a bad coach. I mean, I know a little bit about, you know, I mean, and I don't mean this disrespectfully because she seems like a wonderful person. I've met Chris Weidman's mom. She's a lovely, very nice lady. But I don't think that she has a lot of credentials as far as competition and coaching. And so I think there's the difference. I do have a lot of credentials. I literally wrote a book on winning at Network.
Right.
And I think that, you know, my doctorate is in applied statistics. And what statisticians do is basically detect patterns in data. And you can look and say that people who train only at one place, people who don't take advantage of others who can help them, coaches who try to keep away other people with a lot of credentials, do not benefit people. You can look and say, if you have a club where the majority of people don't win more than 50% of the time, if you look at, you know, look at people's records. I mean, I love Marina Shafir to death, but she lost 2 out of 3 matches. That's my training. I'm a statistician. I'm paid to look at data and give you, to the best of my ability, objective and accurate results, and not give you what you want to know, but give you what the data show, and to the best of my ability, which I would be immodest enough to say fairly well regarded in my field. And if I look at data and say, on the average, you should win 50% of your fights, because, you know, in every fight somebody wins. So if you're not winning, if your players are winning 50% of the time, they're doing no better than the average. If they're winning less than 50% of the time, they're doing worse than the average. And so you just look at the facts. And I've always said, and it wasn't original to me, but it's still true, everyone's entitled to their own opinion, but they're not entitled to their own facts.
Right. Wow.
So, yeah, speaking of statistics, actually, tell us, what is seventh generation games? I was trying to read and figure out, you know, how to even decipher what it was about, and I figured I'm just going to ask you, because it looked really interesting.
If you ever play like World of Warcraft or Grand Theft Auto or Super Mario Brothers.
Grand Theft Auto, yeah, Super Mario for sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, some people call Spirit like Grand Theft Horses. Imagine if by the time you got to level 20, you were ready for algebra. How cool would that be?
Oh, interesting.
So they're educational for middle school to grades to junior high school, or?
Yeah, pretty much it's funny. Every game we do turns out to be for a much broader market than we had envisioned. So basically, Fish Lake, you learn a little bit about history and a lot about fractions. So it's really based on a true story, and so is Forgotten Trail, our third game. And so you learn history and math at the same time. So really what happened in this country 1,000 years ago is the Ojibwe people, who are now in North Dakota, Wisconsin, Minnesota, where I am right now, 1,000 years ago, they, before there were horses, before there were cars, they picked up everything they owned and walked halfway across the continent. And why would they do that? And nobody really knows. So we started out with this story that maybe it was because they were running out of food. And if you were running out of food, you wouldn't wait till everybody was starving and laying around dying and go, oh, wow, this sucks. You know, maybe if you're smart, and I believe that Native Americans were smart and observant,
that you would notice that, hey, you know, the amount of fish in the lake that's edible is going down, right? Like, last year, we went out, we caught 125 fish, and 25 of them were a foot long, and we went fishing this week, and we caught 16 fish, and only two of them were a foot long. So you have to figure out, are there fewer edible fish? And if you could solve that, which is basically a question of equivalent fractions, then you'd realize, man, we're going to starve to death. We should leave. And if you get it wrong, then you die. Yeah. In the game, you die. Oh. And then you have to go and study some more and get back in the game. And if you get it right, then you get to, like, jump over all these snakes that are in the path and run down to where the fishing spot is and fish with spears and, you know, catch the fish. And so everything in the game is like that. There's an actual historical cultural fact about Native American history or in Aztec games about Latin American history. So you learn history, but then you also learn math in context. Like another part, like in Spirit Lake, you come into the village and there's nobody out. And you go into the first teepee and the mom says, everybody's sick. You need to go out in the herbs, out in the woods and find this herb and get three for each person because that's how much you need to make medicine. And so you go out and on the way, you're attacked by wolves.
So it's like multi-layered problem solving then. It's like
Right. And, you know, if you came back with the wrong number of herbs, then, you know, there'd be lots of puking because you overdosed people. And it turns out that middle school students are highly amused by people puking in games.
Absolutely. So, I'm laughing right now.
So we try to teach math that math matters. And the reason that I started doing this, you know, Maria talks about it, my oldest daughter, and when she gives presentations to investors, is the reason my kids have the opportunities they have now is 50 years ago, I was good at math. And because I was good at math, I got a scholarship to college, got an education that enabled me to give my kids an education, which enables them to give their kids an education, enabled them to have all these opportunities. And so that's where the seventh generation came from. That, I mean, sports are wonderful, don't get me wrong. But when you look at what makes a difference in somebody's life, if you can change, if I could go back and change somebody's life, pick anybody, somebody who's in jail, whatever, somebody who's working at 7-Eleven, if I could go back and when they were about to drop out of school, I could change that. So instead they graduate from high school, maybe went to college. How much would that change their whole life?
Right.
And so that's, and then it would change their kids' life. So what we try to do, it's what happens to a lot of people. If they're doing okay in school, I mean, you know, most little six-year-olds, they like school. You know, that's why we didn't start with a little bitty kid, you know, with like first, second grade. They like school. Then they get into something that's maybe a little hard. And they start thinking, maybe I'm not good at math. Maybe I suck at math. And, you know, generally, you're only willing to admit you suck to a certain point. So it's not that you suck, but school sucks. I think I'll quit.
Yeah, you redirect your frustration.
But if instead, when it was starting to get difficult, we could give you something that's kind of fun to do, like a game, and in the game, if you get something wrong, you get routed to a page that says, pick how you want to learn. Do you want to watch a movie? Do you want to do an activity? Like, you know, drag equivalent fractions to match? Do you want to read some web pages? Do you want to read to you? So you can learn however it's comfortable for you. You can take however long you want. And you're playing the same game in the same class as everybody else, so nobody knows you're on level 4 and you're on level 6. And maybe if you are, you're on level 4 because you suck at shooting wolves. I mean, I'm really good at math, but I suck at shooting wolves with arrows. So, you know, you, if we could intervene at that point, which is what we try to do, then maybe you would decide, well, you know, I'm okay now. And yeah, maybe I'll stick it out to school because my mom really wants me to graduate. And so it would change your whole life.
That's pretty cool.
That's what I do.
Okay, just a couple more quick questions before we let you go, Doctor. I'll let my co-host, Jonathan King, go ahead and ask you one.
Oh, yeah. I mean, since you won the world championship, what year was that you won the world championship?
84, Vienna. Come on, son. Okay. Did you do research?
84. So 1984, because you touched on it earlier how...
I'm America's oldest living world champion.
Are you really?
At age
37? You're the oldest?
Yeah, you're not a day over what?
I'm 57.
Oh, wow.
Whoa, stop it.
I won in 84. That was 31 years ago. I'm good at math.
Well, you touched on it earlier about how you that competitive drive to become the best, to become the best, and to become great at something, to become successful, and then all of a sudden you find out that you're there, and you have that weird, weird realization that you've kind of conquered. Now what? You brought up the silk sheets analogy. It seems like, you know, Rhonda's at a point now where she's pretty much done everything that you can do in mixed martial arts. I mean, she's won the title. She defined the division. She smashed through a glass ceiling. Before her, women's combat sports, at least on the mainstream, were kind of viewed as a sideshow. Her place in history is set. If she were to come back and fight Holly again, what do you think the single motivation would be?
To prove that she wasn't wrong the first time. You asked me. But that's pure speculation on my part.
All right, Doctor, before we let you go, I've got to hit you hard with the brutally honest, rapid-fire yes or no answers. We just need a yes or no. Or if you want to elaborate, you can, but it's rapid-fire. First, is Edmund the Diamond responsible for Rhonda's success inside the cage? Yes or no?
No.
You've said in the past that you call Rhonda's boyfriends Bob, because by the time you can figure out their name or learn their name, they're already gone. Yes or no? Is Rhonda's current boyfriend known to you as Bob?
Yes.
Was that a yes or no?
Yeah, it was yes.
That was a yes.
Wow, wow.
All the girls' boyfriends are Bob until they are married to them.
Okay.
Wow, last one. Yes or no? Is Rhonda going to the Marine Ball, or did that already happen?
Yes or no? I'm pretty certain she is. I think she's going tomorrow.
Okay.
I'm in North Dakota, but I think she's going tomorrow.
That's awesome. I'm so glad she's doing that to help and support the troops. And before we let you go, I want to ask you, are there any charities or organizations that you support that we could make a small donation in your name to for giving us the time tonight?
Oh, there are a zillion. But you know what I would really like? And anybody who wants to help out? Gompers Judo, Rhonda started this program. Here's the thing, too, and I want to say this. I don't know if she has time, but I'm going to say it anyway.
Oh yeah, you have as much. We just don't want to. We didn't want to keep you because we know you're so busy.
Here's the thing. Card you didn't ask me these questions. Sometimes people say, "Is there anything you didn't ask me that I want?" You know, one thing people don't know about Rhonda is she has a heart of pure gold. She supports so many charities you have no idea about. There was a church that needed a chapel built, and they were short like $11,000. And Rhonda said, "I got $11,000. Done."
That's amazing. You know, that's the thing about people who are so giving is they don't tell you about it, so people wouldn't know.
There's a school in downtown LA. I didn't even know this. That for the last 2 years, she's been buying their uniforms for soccer. The custodian comes after school and coaches all these kids, and they had 40 kids on the soccer team, and she'd been buying their uniforms for the last 2 years because the school couldn't afford uniforms. Wow. And then the only reason I found out about it is some of the kids didn't have shoes. And one of the teachers there contacted me and said, would Reebok maybe be able to give them shoes? And they did.
Wow.
But, you know, it goes on and on and on and on. You have no idea. She gives so much to charity, to so many schools and after-school programs and church programs. And she raised money for the Community Outreach Medical Services and puts it on them, presents them the check. She raised money for Dee Dee Hirsch Mental Health Services to help women with eating disorders. There's just such a long line of thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars of money that she has raised and given away to charity. People haven't the faintest idea about it. So anybody who has anything bad to say about Rhonda can bite me. She's raised, and here's another thing, ever since I think she was in Strikeforce, before every fight, she's had a contest for the World Food Program on the free rice thing to raise money and had contests. I mean, they've raised some incredible amount, like 100 million grains of rice or something, feed like tens of thousands of people. And yeah, she does all of this stuff. And another thing that she does is Gompers Middle School, which is in South Los Angeles. It used to be called Watts, but now they call it South LA because I guess that sounds better. It doesn't seem to me the neighborhood's gotten any better, but
those terms were invented by realtors, you know for a fact.
Right. But Rhonda started that program, I think, 5 or 6 years ago when her sister Jennifer was a student teacher there and asked Rhonda, That must have been, it was 6 years ago, because Ron had just come back from the Olympics. And so it was in 2009, in the spring semester. Jen said the school program wanted, they wanted to have somebody teach judo there, but they had no money. And Ron said, I'll teach it for free. Now, this is a kid who's working three jobs and got an Olympic bronze medal, a world silver medal, won I don't know how many Pan American gold medals, junior world gold medal, and says, I will teach for free in this after-school program. So she started it. She taught there for 2 or 3 years. And then when her MMA career took off, I was substituting for her, and it ended up, I ended up teaching there. But Rhonda still funds that whole thing. She sent those kids to the national championships for freestyle judo. We just came back from this fabulous mini camp in Newport Beach that all the kids stay in a hotel there. We had a team dinner there. We had a college counselor who's a good friend of mine came in and talked to all the kids about college admission requirements. We had practice every day on the beach. My friends at Gracie Bar in Newport Beach let us have their club for free. You know, but Rhonda covers the cost of everything out of her own pocket. And, so anybody has anything bad to say about Rhonda, you don't know her like I do. And she doesn't say anything. But here, I haven't even got to the end yet. So usually once or twice a year, she comes to conference and she teaches. And she doesn't tell anybody. They don't let any cameras in. The only pictures or videos you will see are on the cell phones for those kids, of those kids. And she tells them, there's no media here because I do this for you. It's not like some presidential candidate, you know, washing one dish for the cameras.
Where is this at again? Sorry, the phone kind of cut out. Where was this at?
It's in South Los Angeles, in Watts.
Oh, okay.
It's at Gompers Middle School.
No, I got you. Sorry.
So anyway, that your whole question of if there's any charity, one thing, so somebody, God love them, a friend of mine donated judo gis for all the kids. Because they had gis that, you know, friends of mine's kids outgrew, and, you know, and then some of the kids Jesse Moya, that runs Moya Brand, God love him, he, 1 year gave all the kids judo gis their size. But they're middle school kids, so they grow, right?
Right. Mm-hmm.
So we had somebody this year buy them all Adidas judo gis. But what they don't have is any kind of gi bag, anything to carry them in. So when we go and check in the hotel, I know all these kids are, like, bringing their stuff in plastic bags from the grocery store. So what I would really, really like, if anybody could help me out, I got 24 kids, I would like, you know, like a gi bag, something that you carry your gear in. Do you know
absolutely,
what I'm talking about?
Yeah, gear bags.
That's what I would really like. That would gladden my little heart for Christmas.
Write that down, Aaron.
We're gonna write this down and see if we can help out with that cause.
All right, well, Dr. Anne-Marie, I really appreciate your time, and thank you also for telling us that stuff about Rhonda that normally we wouldn't have heard, because it actually does influence people's opinion, and it is really nice to hear that she's such a humanitarian, and it sounds like she might have a more fulfilling career in life outside of the cage. So I really appreciate you doing that, and once again, thank you so much for your time. Please, if you haven't already, check out her website, 7thGenerationGames.com, to see her educational video games. Also, is it on Amazon, Doctor?
Yeah, where can we find your book?
Yeah, where can we find your book? On Amazon, please.
Oh, my book? Waiting on the Ground? Yeah, it's on Amazon, or you can find it on the Blackbelt Magazine website, wherever.
Waiting
books
on the Ground.
All right, well, Dr. Anne-Marie DeMars, I just want to say on behalf of the Brutally Honest Show, thank you so much for your time tonight. You are an incredibly well-spoken, charming lady who is also extremely accomplished and educated, and it was an absolute pleasure to get to speak to you for the first time. Thank you so much for your time tonight.
Well, you're very welcome.
Thank you very much.
All right, Dr. Anne-Marie DeMars. Woo!
Wow.
All right, that was a pretty insightful, really interesting interview with Dr. Anne-Marie DeMars. That was really fun. Thank you so much for organizing that, Clinch. We really appreciate that. What stood out to you from that interview?
You know, I think the main thing was the way she broke down the whole her whole issue with Rhonda's coach. You know, I had a feeling that it wasn't an emotional attachment that drove her to say what she said. But you know, she broke it down. She said in her opinion, statistically, he is not the right coach because he's not producing the right results. Now, the popular opinion is you don't tell a cat, or, you know, if something's not broke, you don't fix it. And Ronda's judo is the best in MMA, and I do think it was a mistake to have her believe in her boxing so much. But you know, that's just my opinion. I'm no coach, so.
Well, I think that you have to be able to adapt and overcome. Basically, the military strategy. It's adapt, overcome, and basically have a new game plan.
And the
you
one-
know, you need to be able to adapt. But the thing that I took from this interview the most was that Ronda's mom is so freaking well-spoken. She was so articulate. She came with the facts. You can't argue with the facts. And that's what she's all about, being from a statistical background. Also, the charitable work she brought up about Ronda,
yeah.
I was really impressed by that.
I didn't know about a lot of that stuff. Yeah. I knew cool. Ronda's a generous person, but that's freaking unbelievable, the shit she's doing.
Well, the thing is, I think people who are like that, they won't tell you they do it. So for people, I had no idea at all. And I'll be honest and say that does change. It doesn't really change my opinion because I never really had a bad opinion about her as a person anyway. But it sure as hell improves my feelings about her as a person. It's really interesting. Yeah. I'm really glad her mom brought that stuff to light because she could possibly go down as a humanitarian. When all is said and done, people are probably going to read about her. I took a women in sports course in college, a class, and you study Maya Rudolph. You know, I think her mom actually was even part of the class. But basically, it's women in sports
Maya
history.
Maya Rudolph, isn't she a comedian on Saturday Night Live?
It's something Rudolph. It's a woman. It was an African-American woman. It's an African-American.
I think that's who it is. Am I wrong?
I don't know. He got caught.
I'm gonna look
is it Maya Angelou?
No. It's going to be Rudolph 100%.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
But so anyways, I'll look it up again, but I'm going to look it up and then rub it in your face. The point I'm trying to make is that her charitable work and what she's done for providing a role model for women, a powerful example, that could possibly be her crowning achievement, not being a UFC champion.
You know, the other thing that when I was doing my research for this, Dr. Anna Marie and I were going back and forth with emails, and I started reading her blog. Another company that she owns, I think, is called the Julia Group. It's named after her daughter or something, and she has this blog that she wrote, and it's all about the things in life that she's done wrong. The times that, you know, I'm a successful person and this, that, the other thing. But, you know, when I look back at things and I say, if I was nicer, she was like, I never got fired from a job for being not nice to somebody. But I probably could have got further if I had handled myself differently. And my dad always told me the smartest people are the ones that can look at themselves objectively and tell you, this is what's wrong with me, and be right on the nose about it. And that's what kind of gets me about Dr. Anna Marie, is she seems like that kind of smart. You know, it's transcending. It's a different kind of smart. It's not book smart. It's like an intuition almost. And
she's well traveled. Yeah. She has cultural experience, educational experience, combat sports experience. She's been there and done that.
And she's brutally honest.
Exactly.
So we freaking love that.
Speaking of being honest, okay. So the name, it's Wilma Rudolph.
Oh,
Wilma Rudolph.
Yeah, but she's
but Maya Rudolph's the real funny girl from Saturday Night Live. So I was right.
So Wilma, so whatever. But Wilma Rudolph, she actually had polio.
Points for you.
All right. Well, whatever. She had polio, and plus was African American during a time of discrimination, and she overcame people telling her, like Forrest Gump style, she had to wear braces. And she went out to be the fastest woman in the world, and I think won the Olympics.
Nice. Yeah.
Wow. So anyways, and thank you very much to Dr. Anna Maria DeMars. That was an incredible interview. So we're going to give our predictions real quick for the fights. I think maybe we have one call coming in, and then we're going to get out of here. We've had an incredible show so far. We want to end on a high note. So guys, what are your picks? We'll just do... I have all the fights here, actually. Do you want to start in order of when they're going to take place?
Yeah, sure.
Let's
do it rapid, though. Like, bang, bang, bang.
Okay, the Ultimate Fighter is the first one, right?
Yeah. No. Fight Night's the first one.
Actually, geez, I don't have it.
Fight Night is the Nama Yunus. I love
that name. Okay, so PVZ, Paige VanZant versus Thug Rose.
I got Thug Rose.
Adrian?
I got Paige.
I'm going with Paige. I would go with Thug Rose, actually, but Paige looks so much more healthier. She looked way better at weigh-ins, and I think the UFC's pushing her, making things comfortable for her, which isn't a bad thing or knock on her, and also her training camp. Trevor Whitman and Pat Barry is not enough. Even though I know they have more than that, it's just, man, Paige has world class. Alpha Male is really putting together an incredible team.
I think that's some of a factor. I think the bigger factor is, my opinion, is that Paige is going to put more pressure on Rose and be able to overcome.
The weigh-in changed my opinion 100%. Rose didn't look good at the weigh-in.
It's the energy. Much closer fight than the Paige Van Zandt geeks like to think it is.
Yeah. Oh, well, I think Rose is going to bring it to her.
Yeah, but
it's just... So anyways, moving on, just on that card as well, Sage and Cody Pfister.
Who do you got?
I have Sage Northcutt winning the fight.
I do too. He looks so much larger and more muscular than Pfister. Pfister's no joke. He has an incredible record. He's tough as nails. But, man, Sage looks like a prize fighter in there. Plus, he's super sexy, dude. He's super sexy.
What is Pfister known for? What is he?
I think he's a wrestler. Like, he's just a grinder.
He's a wrestler?
He's just a tough guy.
He's an overall tough dude. He's got some skill, though. I think he's in the Team Takedown.
Yeah, he's on Team Takedown, but... Yeah. No, it's Texas.
Oh, Texas, rather. Sorry.
Basically, they're from two different sides of Texas.
Oh,
Sage is from the rich, suburban side, and then Cody's from kind of the poorer side.
Well, I do know Sage has a purple belt in jiu-jitsu.
And he wrestled as well. People say, he wrestled for 2 weeks in high school or some bullshit, but he wrestled.
I'm going to go for the underdog.
Is he in high school
yet? Pfister?
I'm going to go for Pfister. Pfister.
See, I'm going with Sage. I don't know a lot about either one of the fighters, and it's my – when you don't know about either one of the fighters, look at the matchup itself. The UFC has a lot invested in Sage. They don't have a lot invested in Pfister. So I'm going with the UFC to protect their investment in this.
Okay, Sage I watch Sage videos all night. I studied everything about him. I know everything about Sage. So if you want to know something, ask me.
How big is his schmeckle?
Man, weigh-in day Sage today, sponsored by Reebok with a neon green trim. He was flexing the hog, son. Yep. He was flexing the hog, son. Don't get it twisted. You might be surprised. Man. He's got a hog.
All right, next matchup.
Okay. So, Aldo versus McGregor.
Easy for me.
Who?
Aldo. Aldo, all day.
All day, Aldo.
All day, Aldo.
You're going for Anderson Aldo all day.
the Mahler.
I'm going to have to disagree with my very close friend over here.
Oh.
Kenny Florian, who we spoke to earlier, and agree with the schlep on my right. Jose Aldo all day.
Man, my heart says Jose, but... Just for the troll aspect, I almost want to see McGregor win just because people will be so frantic. But if I had to bet money on this, dude, I'm going. I love Aldo. I want Scarface Aldo to win. Anderson Scarface Aldo.
I'm gonna say Aldo with a left hook, maybe even like a kidney, like a liver shot, you know, something like that.
I think Aldo takes out McGregor's front leg.
Yeah, because he sticks it out quite a bit.
So far,
but he might bait him with it. So who knows? We'll see. Yeah. Next.
Okay. Let's see here. Weidman. My favorite Jewish fighter other than Rory Singer, Weidman, against Rakold. Am I saying that right?
Rakold.
Am I saying that right? Luke Rakold?
Luke K. Rakold?
No, I'm just messing around. Chris Weidman versus Luke Rakold. Middleweight championship.
Yeah. Undercard. Or
co-main event.
Co-main event. Not
yeah,
the main event.
And usually
co-main.
It's supposed to be by weight class.
Yeah, it is supposed to be by weight class. And I've heard Dana actually say that. Oh, we go by weight proceeds.
Oh, right. Who's right? Yeah.
Not this time. Aldo McGregor's the main event.
Not when you got an accent like this, you fuck.
Not when you got red panty night. You don't fight Coleman
Not
event.
On red panty night.
I'm going to go with Weidman. I'm going to go with Weidman.
This is a really close fight. This is a fucking really close fight. I'm going with Weidman.
I just don't think Luke's stand-up is as good as Weidman's.
It's a completely different type of stand-up.
It is, but...
Because Rakold is he's a kickboxer. He's a kicker. He's got head kicks, liver kicks. A big part of his game plan is liver kicks.
Yeah, but look at when he fought Vitor. I mean,
if this
that's TRT, Vitor.
If this was a war, like physical war, in my idea, the best analogy would be like, what's going to win, a fucking Apache helicopter or a tank with anti-air defenses?
I'm going... Wait, because Rakold beat Jacare?
Yeah, he did.
I'm going with Luke Rakold.
I think that was a split, though. Wasn't it a split?
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. I think, to be honest, Weidman, as you say, is going to win, but screw it. I want the underdog. I want to go for Rakold.
And True Revival Touch Therapy, Vitor doubled over Rakold, back when he was on the original TRT.
Actually, you know what? You can damn, I want Rockhold to win, but to be honest, I think Weidman's going to touch his chin and knock him out. Weidman is so underestimated, and but when he lands, you go to sleep.
People forget that elbow that he caught Mark Munoz.
Yeah, but Mark Munoz wasn't 100%, but yes, I know.
When Weidman gets rocked, he doesn't get fractured. He just gets he gets fucking aggressive.
Also, I think Weidman's jiu-jitsu is better, but go on. Next one.
Okay, so the next, actually, it's not on the list, but it's on that card. It's a big fight. Jacare against Romero.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, that's a good
Sets
one.
Sets the table, bro.
I think that, I don't know if they'll give Romero a title shot if he wins, but they if should. Jacare wins, he gets, he
they
has
should.
To.
I think that.
If Jacare said he's going to hunt down and find and fight Dana White if he's going to title
shot. How much you want to bet if he does win and they do give him a title shot, that title shot comes with English lessons.
That's hilarious.
Well, that's easy for me. I'm going to go with Jacare on that.
Jacare's stand-up is... He has transcended in his stand-up game. He's gotten really, really good.
His boxing has been... Exactly. I was thinking about that today in the car, actually. It's funny because I was thinking about Ronda, and I was thinking about Jacare as a comparison where he was pure jiu-jitsu.
Yep.
Pure jiu-jitsu. But the way he's developed his striking, he's becoming a hell of a striker.
Yeah.
And the thing is, that gives him options. It sets up a takedown. He can wear people out. And... The thing is, I think that if he gets caught or dropped or even taken down by Romero, who's a wrestler, incredible wrestler, he's better on the ground.
Yeah.
So I think that he's more well-rounded, and other than and he's pretty jacked himself. He's got a big physique.
I think Jacare's gas tank is going to be the difference.
That's. I was just going to say, if this was a 5-round fight on Fight Night as a headline, mm-hmm. Jacare hands down. Yeah. But it's a 3-rounder. I think Romero's going to be able to withstand.
You think he'll go to a decision?
I
think Jacare is going to win the fight.
I think Jacare is going to do it by rear naked choke.
I think Jacare is pretty damn world class, and pretty much he's a title contender, number two guy, but I don't know if he's a champion, but he's pretty much a number two guy.
Has Jacare ever been knocked out?
Yeah, he got knocked out by an upkick by Musasi, yes, right? Yeah.
And
that's off the top of my head. I'm
thinking right now, like when I close my eyes and see how Romero wins, it's something like Jacare tying up a triangle from the bottom and him going fucking rampage a la Rampage Arona and picking him up and slamming him on his head.
He got knocked out by Musasi is the only knockout in the last since his first ever fight ever 12 years ago.
That's what I'm saying.
But guess who knocked him out his first ever fight as a pro?
Landry
KO.
Johns?
2003 Jungle Fights. Adrian, he's from the same jiu-jitsu team from Goal's team.
Oh, Macaco.
Yes, Jorge Patino.
Yeah. Oh, nice.
Yeah, Adrian's buddy.
Yeah,
I think Romero wins by slam. That's what I see. I know it's kind of odd, but I see Romero
By slam?
Rampage Romero
okay,
Jackson.
Yeah. If that happens, that's the prediction of the fucking century.
See that happening in my head.
All right, well, those are our fight picks, fucking and we're sticking to them. Before we go, we have one call. Oh, my gosh. Calling. We couldn't get Conor McGregor. I literally have been emailing.
Dude, his uncle.
Paddy McGregor. Ladies and gentlemen, we want to welcome to the show, on behalf of the McGregor family and the McMansion, ladies and gentlemen, Paddy McGregor. How you doing, Mr. McGregor?
Hello, this is Paddy. I've been calling for months, but you guys liked me then, but now you want me now. You give Ronda's mom credit. It's a write-off. McGregor does those things all the time. It's a write-off. You have no idea. He's been moving like crazy in the McMansion. He's doing McIrish ballet. It's like Bar Method up here. It's like Bar Method. And I'm telling him, he's like the male version of Ronda Rousey. He needs to get the attention. He needs to throw on a wig and fight Pan Mom or Ronda. I mean, come on. And boys, Forrest, you need to help me. You need to help me because I'm stuck in here. I'm in the attic. He has no idea I'm calling, but I've been blowing. I'm blowing through all of his money like a mover vacuum. I need help. Help the uncle. Help the uncle.
Oh, Jesus Christ! It's funny. He started out talking about Ronda and Paddy McGregor sounded Armenian there at first.
yeah, I was like, whoa, this
Paddy,
is not
you're
be
fucking
good.
a little bit of a chameleon there, you know?
Yeah. Oh,
he must have found the Irish style because he turned it up about a couple seconds in, you know?
Who was
God damn it?
Who's a better talker, Connor or his Uncle Paddy?
I would have to. I mean,
Patty was pretty good.
Tight race, but I have to go with Connor on that one.
I think that's about all I can handle tonight, guys.
Oh,
what do you
Jesus
think?
Christ.
Yeah,
we got to do our sponsors real quick before I forget, or you forget.
Ladies and gentlemen, if you're not familiar with this, it's called Painaway. Painaway, pain relief, sports therapy. Oh my gosh. This stuff's incredible. I actually used it on my knee a few times. I used it on my quad. I used it on my calf, my shoulder. I don't want to, if I was to compare it to something, I'd compare it to like a sports relief cream that would possibly change in temperatures.
Yeah, but one that actually works.
Well, but I'm just trying to give a comparison without saying the name of another company.
Oh, okay, right on.
That, I'd compare it to, you know, like something you would rub into your skin. And the cool thing is, this right here is our spray bottle one. I have the jar. It's like a cream at home as well.
We have it over there different too, I think, right?
Well, I took one home, though, actually. That's what I've been using.
Oh, nice. Yeah. The fire, the heat
yeah.
one?
Yeah, here, pass that over real quick. Yeah, so here's a pain away. Oh, so this is the fire heat one?
No. The one that's red is the one that says heat.
Well, that's the one I took home, no
yeah,
wonder.
Yeah, that's the good
okay,
one.
Okay, yeah, oh yeah. So I took home the fire heat one, and it basically changes the temperature. Instead of using ice, I rub that on, and it goes from hot to cold.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I really enjoyed that. Thank you very much to Painaway Sports, Pain Relief and Cream. You can go ahead and buy that online or probably in your local stores, and it helps with muscular and joint inflammation stiffness. It helps with tendonitis, sprains and strains, bruising, muscular aches and pains. Great for after training. What else you got, John?
Oh, we got...
Ooh, Edwards Industries.
Our wonderful coffee. Dude, I drink out of this coffee mug.
I have one on my desk. I use it as decoration. I'm too afraid to break it or anything. So we've got from Edwards Industries. Can you do one more close-up of me, Adrian? I'm sorry. We've got from Edwards Industries, we've got our coffee mugs, custom coffee mugs. We've got custom beer glasses. Doing my smile for the show.
It's good stuff.
These things are incredible, dude. They have our logo. And then, I don't know, you can't see inside, but it holds half a pot of coffee. It holds like 12 or 16 ounces. It's crazy.
It's
I love
it.
It's
great for writing in the morning. That's why I use that in the morning. Fit a whole pot in that fucking thing. It's great.
Yeah, and did VMC hook you up this weekend?
Yeah, VMC did hook me up.
We don't need to do a review, but you can just tell the shout out their clinic and stuff.
Oh, yeah. They gave me a new thing for nighttime pain relief. It's actually a concentrate. They gave it to me to try. It's called... It's actually made by Vader Extracts.
By the way, I'm excited for the movie.
Yeah, it's perfect. Vader Extracts, right when Star Wars comes out. It's
I get to go watch the movie before it comes out. I'm so fucking excited.
Spoiler, you want to hold that up? But yeah, it's a concentrate. It's a shatter wax. VMC opened a new location in West Los Angeles. They're on
They're
Pico.
Back in business. Awesome.
Pico and La Brea. They have a new store that can handle up to 50 fucking patients at once.
Wow, that's a lot.
So it's crazy. Go check them out. They're on Weed Maps. My buddy Maj is the manager over there, and he always takes care of us. So thank you to everybody at VMC, which is back up and running.
Wow, what a long show. Hour, 45 minutes, but it felt like it zipped right by. Please, for the love of God, if you believe in anything that's right with this world, would you give us a subscription follow on iTunes? Subscribe to the feed. Listen to past shows. We have incredible guests. What, you don't like Chael Sonnen? You don't like Chris Cyborg for Beast Over Doom? Mick the Nerd?
Porn stars?
Adult entertainers? Jesse Jane? Joanna Angel? Jessa Rhodes? Dr. Anne-Marie DeMars? God, who haven't we had? Matt Brown.
We take everybody.
Who? I mean, Ray Elby. God, who? Eddie Bravo.
Eddie Braff.
Tony Ferguson. Anyways, the point is we
Benil Dariush.
Yes, we've had a ton of incredible
Fabrizio
guests.
Fabrizio Verdum.
Oh, Kyle Cushman, scientist.
Kyle Cushman.
That was one of my favorite ones.
Soon to be Peter Dante.
Hopefully, yeah, get him on. So we should tag along a podcast from the car. No, I'm just kidding. But yeah, so anyways, please subscribe, follow. We've had an incredible show tonight. We want to thank all of our guests for their time, and it's been an absolute pleasure. K-Flo, you were amazing. Dr. DeMars, you were amazing. From the Brutally Honest crew, this is Aaron True on behalf of Jonathan King and Adrian Gallego saying, follow your dreams. They can always come true.